All it does is you have to just have naught, and it's derivative, it's related to alpha, and here you go, it's written in terms of gamma naught, but you can see that your gamma naught is a quotient of these two solutions, and roughly speaking, it comes back linear superposition principle for this. This is a general solution. Well, again, actually, another thing that you are dealing with partial differential equations, the space of solution is infinitely dimensional, right? But if you are trying to look for solution in specific form, how it's done here, right? So then you reduce this infinite system to the system of ordinary differential equations, right? And then if you fix initial data, then you have six-dimensional subspace in this general thing, and then by integrating nonlinear equation by standard inverse scattering technique, you come back to the whole solution. For particular initial data, obviously. There is a whole bunch of questions here about this. Okay, so now, if you've never seen soliton, let me present one soliton solution for the most general integrable system of this kind. Well, you see, so there is a so-called traveling wave solution. You can actually, well, the idea now is very simple. You just take known solutions for a standard Schrödinger equation, right? Use our transformation, and this will give you a general solution. So it's a standard solution. It's even written in terms of new space variable and new time variable. If you use the substitution, then it will give you equation for so-called elliptic functions. For elliptic functions. So here already some integration is done, so you need extra constant of integration. And this equation studied very well in any book on elliptic functions, so let me skip this one. And examples of explicit solution of this, it's obviously Jacobi elliptic functions, and they are double periodic, but among them there is a special case when imaginary period goes to infinity, and in this case you have actually hyperbolic sine and hyperbolic cosine solution. In physics they call it bright and dark solitons. This is how they look in experiment, right? But in general, it's Jacobi elliptic transcendental function. So here you go by our lemma, you take the standard solution, you make a transformation. This is how one soliton solution, or in the case of nonlinear, in case of Jacobi elliptic function, better say nonlinear periodic wave, look like. And f is this elliptic function which satisfies equation which was written before. And by the way, at this point, remember I use p, this parameter in nonlinear term, equal to 2. If I put p as some other number, then instead of these integrals, which are elliptic integrals, it will be so-called hyper-elliptic integrals. And the theory of those is not that actually much more involved, not that well known, but at the same time, this kind of nonlinear Schrödinger equation great use nowadays, right? So we still can do something here, but unfortunately we need another Jacobi and whatever in order to clear up this mess with hyper-elliptic functions, right? So, well, and examples through this transformation, obviously they incorporate so-called non-autonomous solitons, which were in literature for at least 10 years. There are a group of people who are writing papers on this non-autonomous solitons for about 10 years, and they're pretending they are discovering new integrable system. So as our result shows, it's not entirely accurate, right? So they don't need new methods, you need just clever transformation. And the key ingredient of this clever transformation is how to solve linear system. In my opinion, this is actually excellent result. What better could be? Okay, you solve linear system, then you use this information to solve nonlinear, and then you're done. Okay, so maybe I should actually point it out a couple of steps how solution of this standard nonlinear Schrödinger equation can be worked out. Well, first of all, you have to transform it to standard form. Well, this actually nonlinear equation, the most easy looking formula when you have this factor 2. If you put here something different, like 3, 4, or whatever, you have the whole bunch of extra radicals or whatever, then it will be really not pleasant. Then you have to concentrate first on so-called flatness condition. What is flatness condition? Well, under every integrable nonlinear problem, there is a linear problem. You have to construct the linear problem. And linear problem goes out of here. So you introduce two matrices, 2 by 2 matrices, U and V, and you can see the psi, which is solution of this equation, it's in these matrices, right? And then you have to satisfy this equation. So how this explicit is this Zakharov-Shabbat-Oleg pair look like? This is explicit realization. So you can see solution psi and psi squared, and if you plug in this flatness condition, and flatness condition again, it's pretty actually obvious what it is, right? So you're kind of thinking that you simply change, the system will be a little bit later, but you take this new artificial argument u, and you differentiate it with respect to t, and right-hand side is known. Then the same for v. And then you simply, as the order show, you change the order of differentiation, that the result will be this flatness condition, right, or the expect. So here you go, definition of poly matrices once again. So Lux pair is here, and it's the basics of this nonlinear stuff. If you have a Lux pair, then Lux pair is like a theorem. So it has all property, and it's include n soliton solution. You don't have to, I do not know how much time it would be, maybe another 20 years, to these people who work on this non-autonomous soliton to discover n soliton solution. Luckily, we don't have to do that. We can use already existing one and simply transform it. And so on. So this is probably, I have to stop. So on this problem, once again, you can see that it was very important to give this integrability condition. I actually wrote this condition one more time, so you can see H naught, it was a constant in front of nonlinear term in transform form. Those initial data from our Riccati system, coefficient A of T was coefficient in front of second derivative. Well, lambda term is kind of, in a way, for mathematical kind of group of people, because physicists usually work with Hamiltonian, which is self-adjoint. Roughly speaking, you have to write terms px plus xp, and then it's self-adjoint. When you're a mathematician, you can easily break this, and it's actually innocent procedure in this particular case. It only gives you extra term lambda, which is certain definite integral, roughly speaking, of the difference, and this appears also in the integrability condition. But at the same time, it's important to have this generality for the next topic, for this Gross-Pitayevsky equation, for Bose condensate, because when they create Bose condensate, eventually condensate disintegrates. So there is some exchange energy with external world, right? And how to do that? Well, the standard way nowadays is to introduce to Hamiltonian term which is not self-adjoint, and which is responsible for this disintegration. So without knowing that, when you try to write down the most possible solvable mathematical right-hand side, it's already incorporates all this stuff. So now I'm doing very well today. I already done with my Mathematica actually proofs. So now I can slow down and show you some examples. Well, Peter Clarkson, as you know, was for many years editor of Proceedings of American Mathematical Society, and he resigned last year. So, but at the same time, in 1988, he has a first example of equation which is not integrable. So in his honor, I incorporated this actually example. He said that this equation does not actually pass Pinlevy test. I don't want to explain what it is, and therefore is not integrable. Okay, let's take a look at this example. Characteristic equation in this case, it's simply equation for what? Harmonic motion, standard solutions, they're written over here. Well, he wrote here omega, so let's keep his omega. Go through this procedure, right? Well, we have to first work out this term, right? So he didn't know, he put here 2. So now I compute all this stuff, I got this one. Well, it's look ugly, but I have to carry all this initial data, I can renormalize. It will probably will look nicer, but it's not my moment, my problem at the moment. So this is what he should have actually put here, all right? So then it's totally integrable, transformable. So how the transformation look like? Here you go, if you go through Riccati type system, and this part is not automized, yes, you have to do it in, or maybe Christoph eventually will write something about this, or maybe I will have to learn more of Mathematica, right? So anyway, this is actually still pain in whatever place of your body is, you have to do it by hands. So, but this is the result. So, six system, six parameters, whatever. So, you have to do that. And this is the simplest substitution who does it. And it's already appeared in paper Gagnon and Winternitz on 1980 something. You see, but obviously now we have six parameter system, so our transformation, it's automatically six has extra six parameters. What to do with this parameter is another story, but this is a subject for another talk. You see, roughly speaking, summarizing, these parameters, they actually usually give you a new solution for simple harmonic oscillating, right? So, which are missing in any textbook on quantum mechanics.
So Clarkson made a mistake?
No, he didn't make a mistake. He said that this is an example of equation which is not integral. So now he said, okay, let's take a look at this equation. You see now, again, it's written already in my form, right? So Clarkson case was when this sin is zero, so roughly speaking, here it was a constant. In his case, it was another constant, the same constant too. Then he said, look at this equation. You see this I, whatever. This was an integral. So I'm just doing this in the most general case, and I'm explaining why. Because
so
in one case, he didn't take integrability conditions the way how we know now. In another case, he was lucky, and he did. In general case, but he put here something, which in his case, obviously, he wanted to have a constant, so it was the same constant, and this is what?
Oh, this explains his.
Right. Not 2012. What happened in 1958, right? But it's 2012, what happened in, 1982, something. I think it would be very nice to say a good word about Peter Clarkson. He is really outstanding person in nonlinear things, and this equation, I admire this example. Okay, so now I have to finish. There is a whole bunch of these solitons. Well, maybe one example only. This is another classical paper in 76, and what is done, it's for the first time, they added pretty much constant force, like a potential to standard soliton theory. And what the result is? Well, they found out that soliton, what Zakharov and Shabbat actually described, will accelerate as a particle, right? Okay, so this is our nowadays interpretation. We go through this procedure. We find the transformation, which is already in the paper, and it was indicated by Tappert. Right, so here you see it's again not easy calculation if you go by hand, but eventually, because you have to carry all these six parameters, but eventually you can simplify and find this transformation. So what else? We're trying to do something on our own, so now you go to ugly equation, which has all these terms run dead. So we transform it somehow, it doesn't matter, and in a moment it will be clear why. So there is a second solution. So you can transform this equation to so-called Penglevy solution, right? And because I have only 3 minutes, just let me show how this Penglevy solution look like. It's like non-linear Airy function, there is somewhere a graph here, and this is a graph. As you can see, this is non-linear, which has term f cubed. So when you go plus and minus infinity, those terms in four-bounded solution do not matter. So on one side, asymptotics, it has the same like for usual linear. And another case, it's oscillate, but it has a shift. And this is a whole bunch of papers about this shift. But what's interesting from physical viewpoint, that this soliton should, it never been observed yet, have a different properties, right? So what will happen if you put this system in external linear field potential, which constant force. So then it's a non-linear system. The soliton will change its shape. It becomes this Penglevy 2 soliton. But it will move with constant velocity as what? Free particle. You see, this is what I'm trying to kind of propagate this idea among physicists. If somebody is interested, it probably would be easy to observe in an experiment because behavior would be totally different, right? So, and non-linear things, non-linear modes, they change the soliton shape, but it still have actually right limits, zero here, zero there, with kind of tail, like a virus or whatever. And this actually the whole combination, like collective wave, will move with constant velocity when external force is applied, instead of actually accelerating as a free particle. So, okay, right now I have only 1 minute, because I promised, well, there is lots of mass here, I don't have time to talk about Gross-Pitayevsky equation. It's all, let me just go back, go to my conclusions. So to summarize, we have shown that you can start from much more general version of Schrödinger equation, which concerns a whole bunch of free function of time, and you can actually construct a transformation and transform it to standard form, and this standard form is totally integrable by classical papers, and then combination of these two things give integrability in some sense of your original system. And I already mentioned a couple of times it's important for Bose-Einstein condensation. So there are a few references, this is some support. So this is a nice picture of Arizona. Mm-hmm. And in Arizona, you know that the government's trying to get rid of so-called illegal immigrants. So the science, we first trying to start a little bit of Spanish. So welcome to our state, forget about stupid politicians. And my special thanks to my graduate student who 2 weeks ago defended her PhD. Without her help, obviously, I'm not capable to make those slides looking so beautiful.
Thank you very much.